praise the Lord. Thank you, ladies. Appreciate the message and singing tonight, and as well as this morning. Thank you for that. The message tonight is going to be found in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 16. If you have your Bibles, let's go to Matthew chapter number 16. I need to set my water up there. In need of that. Matthew chapter number 16, if you are able, would you please stand with me? Good to see everybody in church, our young people, our seniors, and middle age. What a great crowd. Appreciate that. Especially on a Sunday night. You do know that most people don't even have church on Sunday mornings anymore. You know, there's a trend today to have church on Saturday night. So Sunday's your day. Sunday, not your day. Sunday's the Lord's day. It's the day Jesus resurrected from the grave. It's the day we assemble together to commemorate and acknowledge the resurrection. Good to see you. Matthew chapter 16, verse 21. From that time forth began Jesus to show unto his disciples how that he must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed and be raised again the third day. Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, Be it far from thee, Lord, this shall not be unto thee. But he turned and said unto Peter, Get thee behind me, Satan. Thou art an offense unto me, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but those that be of men. Then said Jesus unto his disciples, If any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. And whosoever will save his life shall lose it. And whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. I would like for us to read verse number 24 and 25. These are very instructive and very important verses in the life of a disciple. Then said Jesus, we'll do this together. I'm sorry, let me get us back on the run here because I think it's wonderful and we're all doing this in unison. So we'll start now in verse 24 and we'll read verse 25. We'll start now. Then said Jesus unto his disciples, If any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. And whosoever will save his life shall lose it. And whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. Well, this is our subject for tonight. Deny yourself so that Jesus Christ can be the Lord of your life. Deny yourself so Jesus Christ can be the Lord of your life. Or if Jesus Christ is going to be your Lord, denial of self is going to be necessary. Denial of self is going to be necessary. Father, thank you for the evening. Bless the word. Holy Spirit of God, I'm thankful that you're here. And I'm thankful that you hear me. And I'm thankful that you're going to bless the message. I know these things, and I thank you for it. This is not of our own self. This is of the word of God. Our goal tonight is to glorify the Lord Jesus Christ. Bless now and do just that. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. The disciples are midway through their training. As they have matured in about a year and a half, maybe 2 years, somewhere in that area, as they have matured, Jesus's truths and the reality of biblical teachings that are mature start to become more in the air. So as they have grown in grace and as the disciples have matured in faith, the teachings get a little bit more intense. Very intense teaching here, where the Lord Jesus Christ tells his disciples that he's going to be killed. This is perhaps the climax of news in the ministry of Christ with his disciples that would have startled them, that would have shook them. From that time forth, Jesus began to show unto his disciples how that he must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and the chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised again the third day. Now, I would suppose, and be killed. That phrase perhaps stuck and was ironed in their conscience more than anything. I know it was ironed in their conscience more than the resurrection, because the resurrection that he talks about here, being raised again the third day, would give hope and joy to the sadness of the news that he was relaying, that he's going to die for humanity. Prior to this revealing of the purpose of Christ, he asked a great question. This is also in preparation for what they would need to learn as they would minister in his absence physically, but not personally, because the Holy Spirit of God was with them. He said, "Who do men say that I am?" Amen. Now, they had a real good idea who he was. There was enough miracles, signs, wonders, and preaching, and just marvelous things done, that they had enough faith at this time to know the answer to that question. Who do men say that I am? But the disciples would need to know something about that question, and that is this. They would need to know that men in general, during their ministering, after his departure, would have a perverted, lopsided view on who Jesus is. That their message would be rejected because of people not recognizing who he really is. So the question is asked, and some answers are given. Two answers particular. Well, some say that thou art John the Baptist. He was not. But this is how men could have viewed Christ. They have a mixed up view about who Jesus is. And some say that you are Isaiah. Some think that you're Jeremiah or Jeremias, or you're one of the prophets. So the majority of the people in that day did not have a clear perception on just who Jesus was. Has a lot changed? I don't ask you the question for the answer. You don't ask me the question for the answer. All we just look at is the professed people of and in the sphere of religion. What do people today think about Jesus Christ? Well, you don't need to ask the question. Just look at how they live. Look at what they're dedicated to. Look at what they embrace and look at what they refuse. So when he asked the question, "Who do men say that I am?" My thought is he was teaching his disciples, men, not everybody is going to think of me the way you think of me. And you're not going to, you should not allow the way that men think of me in a perverted view to interfere with what I'm calling you into. If this one denies you, keep going. If this one has a wrong view, and I'm talking about Christ, if this one has a wrong view of me, keep going. If this one doesn't understand who I am, keep going. If this, keep going. Now, what do you profess me to be? So that was part of the other question here. Who do you think I am? Well, and Peter answered and said, and by the way, no one disagreed with Peter's answer. Peter said, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Peter's perception was right on. This is for and from the fact of what Christ says, "Blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah," because you didn't get this from flesh and blood. You got this revelation from my Father. What was the difference in the profession of Peter, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of God," and the whole religious crowd of that day who says, "Well, maybe he's John, maybe he's Elias, maybe he's Jeremiah, maybe he's one of the prophets"? What was the difference? Well, no doubt, insight, or we would say illumination, concerning the Spirit of God. A clear perception concerning Jesus Christ is needed in the life of a disciple. Why is clear perception needed in the life of a disciple? Because if a disciple does not have a clear perception of who Jesus is, they will not have a clear perception of who they are. Well, this was true with these men, and this was true in the Old Testament. Just short, but yet right down to the thought point of illustration. He was ordained a prophet, and he was a good prophet. One of the, what we would call, major prophets. And the Bible says, in the year that King Uzziah died, "I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Above it stood the seraphims. Each had six wings. With twain he covered his face, and with twain he covered his feet, and with twain he did fly. And one cried unto another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And the post of the door moved at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with smoke. Then said I, Woe is me." A clear perception is needed of Jesus Christ so that you can have a clear perception of you. When we think too much of ourselves, we will think too little of him. This was a teaching circle here. This is a teaching thought. Peter answered correctly once again. "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." But yet, just in a very short time, his words were, "I don't know the man. I don't know him. You're one of his, I am not. You are one of his, and I am not." In just a short period of time, Peter would struggle with his profession and would deny Christ. The issue that can arise with practicing denial. "If any man will come after me, let him deny himself." The issue, once again, that can arise with practicing. Paul said, "I die daily." It's a practice in life. We practice self-denial. "Well, I don't know, Brother Tony. Some days are pretty good. It's not that bad. But some days I got to practice, it seems like, denial, self-denial, from the time I get out of bed until the time I go back to bed." Yeah. I am always in the way of Christ in me. So I say it with legitimacy in my personal life. The issue that can arise with practicing denial of self is personal relationship with self. Personal relationship with self. Now, this is the teachings of Jesus. Now, we understand that Paul would say something like this in Ephesians chapter 5. And there's a reason that Paul would say what he said in Ephesians chapter 5 in regarding just the nature of men. And that's really all we want to look at with this thought. And with it parallel in the teaching of self-denial. So, as he is referring to a relationship with a husband and a wife and Christ in the church, he says this. Now watch. For no man ever yet hated his own flesh, but nourisheth it and cherisheth it. That is why practicing self-denial is always a struggle. It's personal relationship with self. But in clear, sober thinking, we come back to the fundamental truth that we have been bought with a price, and we are not our own. Therefore, we're to glorify God with who we are because we've lost the rights to be who we once were or who we think we need to be. Although, now listen, you can practice, and so can I, not. I can practice to not practice self-denial. I can practice not to practice self-denial. Hold on, that thought's coming. I have the liberty tonight to practice not self-denial. I have that liberty. Hold that, just keep that in mind. Okay, so Paul says that no man ever yet hated his self. Fact of the matter is, his flesh. Now I know why this teaching in Ephesians is here. And I know why it's in Romans 8. And I know why it's in Romans 7. Because of what Jesus talked about during his ministry about if you're going to be my disciple, you're going to have to deny yourself or you can't follow me. I know where this teaching comes from Paul. Now, as we think about this, no man ever yet hateth himself, but loveth himself. Hate self. Do I hate myself? Now, I want to be careful with this, and I want to be explanatory. Or do I love myself? Now, sometimes young people, let me say this, young people, we got some young people here tonight. Sometimes young people, you get frustrated with life. Here's what you say, I hate my life. That's not what I'm talking about, young people. You should never hate your life. Regardless of how bad something may be, no matter how upset or bitter, young people, you may feel, you should never hate your life because God has given you life. And you should never hate something that God has given. So that's not what we're talking about. That's not what I mean in any way, shape, or form. Why just hate myself? I wish I was never born. Cursed be the day that they said a man child is coming to the world. We're not talking about that. Okay? Do I hate myself or do I love myself? Well, let me go back to the text, verse 21. He started to talk and teach and show his disciples how that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and the chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised again the third day. Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, "Be it far from thee, Lord, this shall not be unto thee." Okay? Peter is now tempting Jesus to deny himself. Peter is, he is referred to as Satan. The word Satan means this, adversary. Here's what it means. You are trying to trip me up from what I need to do. You're trying to make me, you're trying to divert me from what I know is right. You're trying to puzzle me in what I'm teaching. And he simply says, get behind me. I will not tolerate that, Satan. And he says here, for thou savorest the things not of God, but of men. Now, when a man savors the things of man, it's awfully hard for him to say no to self. But when he savors the things of God, as he is teaching his disciples what the savor, having the right savoring, and that deals with, Brother James Brown tells me he's a master chef. I don't know where he went to, but he's gone. Oh, he's out there? No, he never told me he's a master chef, but I tell you what he has told me. Brother James, I want to cook this on a smoker. This. All I know is my family says, do it again, would you? That's all I can tell you. When are you going to do that thing again? And so it deals with putting things together. So I'll put some butter together, some brown sugar together, some apple vinegar together, and some salt and pepper together, and mix that together. And I make a base with that and put all them ingredients together. And my mom came over for her birthday, and she seen that thing laying in the tub. That is that pork loin all cut up. She goes, what is that, son? Possum? I said, it's possum. She tastes it. She goes, it's awful good. I said, it is good. Be the best possum you ever ate. And chemicals of butter and apple cider vinegar and brown sugar and garlic and tinder and salt and pepper all melted together, mixed up, and put over that pork loin. Right. Amen. It's a savor. And when men savor the things of men, well, it's obviously they're going to have a hard time to some degree lining up with the total things of Christ. But when a person savors the things of God, then they realize this must be a reality in my life. I cannot interfere with this because I am not the preeminent one, or I am not the main subject or the highlight. I am a servant above, not the master, but yet submitted to the master. And there's a difference there on hating self and loving self. And so Peter is tempting Jesus to deny God's will. Now, the question, what is the difference between loving or hating self? And once again, we're not talking about an individual. We're not talking about my life is miserable. Can I just say this? Sometimes young people and elders alike, let me just say this. Sometimes in your life, you're going to go through a little bit of misery. Yeah, I have, Brother Tony. I've been through some misery. Well, you say, you ought to be reading your Bible more. I try to stay in it every day of my life. Or maybe you ought to try listening to some preaching. I about listen to it every day of my life. Or maybe you ought to pray a little bit more. Well, I try to do that just about every day, all day long. Well, maybe you ought to be a little bit better of a witness and tell people about Jesus. I try to do it every day of my life. Well, maybe you ought to quit being so stingy and start sharing your substance and being a good steward of God and honor God with your giving. Well, I do that just about every time I have an opportunity. And what I'm saying is this, from time to time in the life of a child of God, things aren't just peachy. They're not the way that we may think they ought to be. But in those times where things aren't what we want them to be, we cannot, as a disciple, allow that negative situation to keep us from denying self, because if we deny self, we're not going to follow him. And if we don't follow him, we're not going to take up the cross. And we're not going to be a good disciple. And we're going to defeat ourselves with ourselves. Now, so the question between loving or hating self, it's success. It's victory. It's fullness of purpose. It's fulfilling God's plan. It's honoring God. When it comes to fulfilling God's plan and honoring God with our lives, doing something particularly and unique for him, which we would call the will of God, I hate myself because I don't have in me what is needed in me to do that thing right. Amen. And by the way, maybe you don't notice, but maybe you do, but maybe you don't. You don't either. There's not a man in this church building who can afford to flirt around with church. But yet people do it all the time. Flirt around with reading the Bible. But yet people, what's going on here? Well, it's obvious they're not fully savoring the things of God. Now, I'm not making them out to be an evil, bad person. It's just they got some tasting for the wrong things. My mom said, "Is that thing smoked?" I said, "Yeah." She goes, "I can taste it." She goes, "But you know, now they got this stuff called liquid smoke you can pour on." I said, "I don't want the imitation stuff, Mom. I want to go out here in the backwoods and get some hickory from my property and split it up and drop it in there. I don't want a little bottle of some kind of chemical smoke." There is a little bit of a difference. Now, I'm talking about hating and loving. When it comes to being successful in the will of God as a disciple, I'm not saying I've arrived, but I do know this. I know that I can't do it without Christ. I know that I cannot live this life without Christ. Now, I'm going to take it a step further. Brother Marvin, I cannot do this but by maintaining a consistent, day after day, week after week, relationship with Christ. When them doors are open, I want to be here. When I have opportunity to read the Bible, I want in it. When I have opportunity to pray, I want in it. Opportunity to give, I want in it. I have structured my life so that I have learned that in me, that is, in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. So when my flesh starts to savor something and get in the way of Christ, I sometimes need Jesus to look at me and say, "Get behind me, Satan. Look at me. Get behind me, Satan. Thou art an offense to me. You're not savoring the things which be of God, but of your own heart." And from time to time, I need that told to me. I need that told to me. Now, think about the life of Peter, just by illustration's sake. And we're not getting down on Peter, but there came a time in Peter's life. Once again, who do men say that I am? They had a perverted view. John the Baptist, Elijah, Jeremiah, one of the prophets. It's not who I am. But that's how the world sees Christ tonight. And by the way, that's why it's so important for me and you to give the right type of picture of who Jesus Christ is. That's why we don't play games and mix him up with the world. Are you following me? We work on these things. We learn these things. It's not something that happens like that. We learn these things. But Peter, and so he denied him. And then what did Peter say? He said, "Well, I'm going to go fishing." Well, how did he go from that? His savoring. I don't know the whole story about Demas, but I do know that Demas got off track with Paul. And Paul says, "Demas hath forsaken me, loving this present world." You know what Demas needed? And maybe he got it. Maybe one night he was all alone in a very bad place in his life. And maybe he turned on the light, the candle, to do some reading. And there sitting next to him was the Lord. And the Lord looked over and said, "Demas, I want you to know something. Get behind me, Satan. You're an offense to me. You're not savoring the things that be of God, but of man." I don't know. But I know that would have probably encouraged him. I know it encouraged Peter. Now, as we think just about this thought, then I think about Solomon over a period of time, how he started to not withhold anything from his heart that his eyes seen. Now, I understand that because of his kingship, and I understand that about his kingdom. But the thing that he didn't understand is that when he started to exercise his eyes upon whatsoever thing he's seen, it says, "I want it." You say, "That's a baboon. They live across the world. I want 10 of them. I want monkeys. I want peacocks. I want chimpanzees. I want all this stuff." And after a while, he couldn't control. His savoring got in the way, and Solomon got way off track. The nation of Israel, as a whole, just as a corporate body, you know, somewhere there in the middle of their service with the Lord, they definitely got off track with God. And basically, let me just say this. They fell back into love with themselves. And when the Christian savors the wrong thing, you start to have a wrong, perverted perception of who Christ is, and there's only really one person, it's going to be your main attraction. You. You. For no man ever yet hateth his own flesh, but nourisheth it and loveth it. Now, it's just the thought there. Now, when Peter, for example, or Demas, and thank God Peter got back on track, and Demas and Solomon and Israel, when people or illustrations like this, when such fall back into love with themselves, it's at that moment they are defeating divine purpose and divine service. It's right then you have just minimized your total reason for creativity, why God has you, or why God's created you. Now, but let me say this. There has always been, and there always will be, a conflict with and between humanism and revealed truth. It's really what this boils down to. There always has been a conflict between humanism and divine truth. Humanism, it's a doctrine, attitude, or way of life centered upon human interests and human values. It's very extremely dangerous and bad for the Christian. Humanism will ruin your life. But yet, then we think of divine truth or revealed truth. Now we're talking about doctrines of divine inspiration. We're talking about the Holy Bible's plenary inspired writing for man's welfare. Now watch. In this lesson that the Lord is kind of climaxed up to, he feels they're at this place to reveal to him them that he's going to die, he's going to be beaten, he's going to be mishandled, he's going to die, and he's going to be raised again on the third day. He feels that they're ready to understand some of this. He takes this opportunity to turn up the knob about what a disciple is. What is a disciple? Or he takes this opportunity to elaborate on the truth. To be a disciple of Jesus Christ, first of all, calls for self-denial. It's what he says. Then said he unto his disciples, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself. Now watch. What does it mean, self-denial? You know what this means? You know what Webster defines self-denial as? Here, I'll give it to you. Replace you with another. Have you ever done that in your life? Have you ever replaced you for another? That's what self-denial means in Webster's dictionary. In the case of what we're talking about here in our text, self-denial is this: replace your lordship of self with the lordship of Jesus Christ. That's what self-denial is. Replace your lordship. Now, once again, is this a challenge? Let me back up. Yes, this is a challenge. Well, why is this a challenge? Because you're madly in love with you. By nature. Pull out in front of me on a bad day. Amen. Pull out in front of me on a bad day. God help me. To be a disciple of Jesus Christ calls for self-denial. Replace your lordship with the lordship of Jesus Christ. Number two, He says here, if any man will come after me, number one, let him deny himself. Number two, take up his cross. Number two, to be a disciple of Jesus Christ calls for dying daily to yourself. Take up his cross. Are you tonight willing to identify fully with the suffering, shame, and reproaches of Jesus Christ and not be ashamed of them? You willing to bear that kind of burden? Most don't. Most will only go so far, then they say, this is too much. This is too much. Let me tell you what I'm telling. Let me tell you what I think the Lord is telling them here. People struggle with total identification with Jesus Christ. They struggle with it. They struggle with totally identifying with him. I know this is true in Christianity today because of what is coming on the scene, Brother Frank, the last 30 years in the name of Christ with churches. Remove the blood. Remove the hymns. Remove the doctrine. Remove these things because these things are a reproach to people. They're not a reproach to me. These things are what we are built upon. And we live in a world and a culture in Christianity for the most part that says, I don't mind Christian, or they come to a Bible-believing, Bible-teaching church and they leave out and they say, whew, I don't know about all that. That's a little heavy there. Yeah. No, it ain't heavy, friend. It's not heavy. It ain't heavy at all. No, it's not heavy. Well, you have one-timer, two-timer, three-timer. Well, what in the world do you mean one-timer, two-timer, or three-timer? I don't know. Do you go to church once a week, twice a week, or three times a week? Go as much as I can, amen? Amen? Well, I don't know. I'm a one-timer, but I didn't know if you're a two-timer, three-timer. People struggle with totally identifying with Jesus Christ and the shame and reproach he bore on the cross. They don't want to go that far with this. They don't want to go out into a community. And they dare not go to the corner and say, Jesus saves. It'll embarrass you. Hey, they're in this room. They're in this room here tonight. Some of you are embarrassed about him. You won't take the full reproach of him either. You don't want to go so far with him. If I said next week, church, we're all going to go up here on the corner. I'm going to put some of you on Walnut. We're going to go some down to Aurora. We're going to some out here and some out here. And you men are going to get a group. You're going to go preaching. Amen. We would just be a few of us. And I wouldn't. And I'm not trying to minimize nobody. But I'm saying that to draw attention to something that lies within us all. That's all I'm doing. And we got to work on coming out of that. Amen. We do got to work on coming out of that. That's why Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. What, do you think I'm going to go come into Rome and be quiet? You got me mixed up. No. And I think that Paul was a great encouragement to them. Die daily to self. And then he says, follow me. Now, interesting enough, I wanted to look up this word, follow me. You know, I always look up words. In a sermon, I'll look up almost every word I deal with. It's just my habit. What does the word follow Christ mean? Well, he says, follow me. Here's what this means. Replacing your major agenda to God's. You see, early in the ministry, God revealed to Peter, Brother Frank, he had an agenda for him. Follow me, and I'll make you become a fisher of men. Peter got mixed up and messed up on that agenda. He didn't want to total, you are one of his. No, I'm not. He didn't want to get too close to that reproach. Are you following me? He didn't want to get too close to that cross thing. Oh, as long as you're passing out bread and fishes, I'll help. You want to set up some tables for the 5,000, I'm count me in. But if you want to go talking about life and death and being spit on and beaten upon, well, I don't really know the man that well. Just don't know him that good. You are one of his. No, I'm not one of his. And what I'm getting at is following Christ means replacing your major agenda to God's agenda. Biblical Christianity, I believe, Bible, real Christianity, is following Jesus Christ and his demands. Now, the problem with that is this: the savoring of Satan getting in the way, or adversaries. Let's just use the word adversaries, okay? He said, "Get behind me, Satan." Now, I want to conclude this, because now I want you to see what I want. Now I want you to see what I feel the big lesson was here. All right. So he tells them, if any man come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. Now here's where the conclusion thought really comes in. I mean it, this is it. I think this is really powerful. For whosoever will save his life, that's what Peter, Brother Frank, was trying to do with Jesus. That's what Peter was trying to do at the fire barrel. Are you one of his? You are one of his. That's what he was trying to do. Are you following me on this? Watch. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it. And whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. What's he saying here? First of all, a person has liberty to save their life. You do not have to deny yourself. You do not have to take up the cross and bear the reproaches of Christ. And you do not have to follow him. You do not have to live life as God wants, but as you want. You can live life as you want and not according to God's will. You can live your life not according to God's word. You can live your life not according to God's wishes. You can save your life, but you'll lose. You will lose. You'll lose. You have this liberty. But if you exercise it, you will lose. You won't win. Amen. You won't win. See how simple this is? So in other words, if you choose to save yourself, your heart is deceiving you and you're going to lose. Oh, no, but that and this and no. It's not that and this, it's him. It's him. Peter was partaking into this to a degree when he rebuked Christ concerning the cross. But can I say something? Can I say something on the flip side of this? Once again, if you don't want to deny yourself and take up your cross and follow him, you have that liberty tonight. But somebody must tell you you're going to lose. Somebody must be honest enough to tell you this. You think I like telling you that? No, but somebody's got to tell you that. Because you've probably read this 15 times and have never come to this conclusion. But can I tell you this? If you will deny yourself, and if you will take up your cross, and if you will follow him, you're going to win. You're going to win. You're going to find your life. Are you following me here? You're going to find your life. What am I saying? If you'll submit yourself to the lordship of Jesus Christ, you'll win. You'll find you. Amen. You'll find you. And I know to each his own, we're all a little different. I know sometimes some of us got to hit real hard and get up. I understand all that. That's God's business. The main thing is getting it. was talking to somebody just the other day who's limited on their liberty. They're limited on their liberty. Somebody I love dearly. And he said, well, you know, I'm such and such. I said, I know how old you are. I said, but you could still make something wonderful out of your life. I said, I'm here to help you. And there'll be other people waiting to help you. Your life's not over. You've got a choice to make. And he said, I'm going to definitely be focused on making the right choices. I'm going to make the right choices. Because he knows by the choices he's made, he's lost. He's lost. And he knows the only way to turn that losing thing around is make right choices that parallel God Almighty. So deny yourself so that Jesus Christ can be Lord of your life, or if Jesus Christ is going to be your Lord, denial of self is going to be necessary. It's a matter of winning and losing. And I don't know about you, I don't like to lose anything. I'm serious. I don't like to lose nothing. If I'm taking something apart and a little bolt falls out, I'll look for that thing for days. I'll go buy a magnet and drag it around. I don't like to lose anything that belongs to me, except that which is not healthy and that which is not wholesome in the sense of being a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, of course, all of this starts, ladies and gentlemen, with a clear perception and a clear understanding of knowing where salvation is. Salvation is of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's found in his shed blood. Amen. It's by God's wonderful and amazing grace. There's an empty tomb tonight. Amen. And that empty tomb reminds me and you that we have victory over death, hell, and the grave because of the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Let me remind you tonight about something. Let me remind you about something tonight. Although your episodes in life sometime are up and down and they're not pleasant, and sometimes very, very disheartening. If you are denying yourself and you're taking up your cross and you're following him, regardless of what your mind tells you or regardless of what somebody else may tell you, you're on the winning side. You're winning. You are winning. But if you choose to deny, lay down that cross and quit following him, I can promise you, you'll lose. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for the thought tonight. I